And that's the model on which we kept progressing. Needless to say that that model itself, because of inherent inadequacy of resources in India, had its own deficiencies. But it did create a basic infrastructure for industrial development which was required in India. India is predominantly an economy which was agrarian in character, and at that stage more than 80% of the people were involved in agriculture as a source of livelihood. And in fact, underemployment in that field itself was writ large. The inadequacies of that system were being felt in the decades of the 70s and the 80s. And finally, it was in the early 90s, 1991, that we decided to make our break with that more regulated planning which we had earlier. We evolved into a new model. And that's when the turning point for the liberalization of the Indian economy itself grew. When we look back the last 26 years, it's been a more than a satisfying journey for India. Initially, we started this whole process with a major step of de-licensing, not requiring any state permissions to set up an industry, which in the pre-91 regime was highly regulated. We started off by liberalizing our currency laws. We opened up, partly, subject to certain conditionalities, our doors for international investment, which indeed started flowing in. We started rationalizing our taxation rates and tariffs, which were initially very high. That made our products more competitive. And we undertook that journey with a good initial impact. The immediate effect of this was that a pre-91 economy, which was predominantly an economy of shortages, suddenly, with year after year, started witnessing most of those shortages disappear. Our growth rates, which were less than modest in the pre-91, suddenly started picking up. And we started off initially with a growth of about 6 to 7%. And then successive governments, year after year, started taking strides in continuing that process forward. The success of that experiment itself had emboldened governments. The next year, of course, was rationalization of direct taxes, which were indeed very high in India. They were brought down and brought down to international levels, opening up important sectors which had all been reserved for government monopolies, services sectors like the telecommunications, etc., and opening up did help. And suddenly we found our core competence in sectors like the information technology, telecom, automobiles, pharmaceuticals. These became success stories which got to be replicated. That was when the next big step was required. And the next big step was, how do we make a leap forward as far as the creation of better infrastructure is concerned? And then started programs like the creation of national highways, improvement in the air connectivity system, particularly with the introduction of private players, increase in the capacity of ports, and these strides started moving forward. The global boom period from 2003 to 2008 really saw this economy pick up at greater heights. And with the support of the global winds behind us, we now moved from that 6%, 6.5% growth rate upwards towards 7, 8, and even 9% in given years. Our average growth rates had become much higher. And I think what was most significant also was the resilience capacity that the Indian economy had. Even the shocks and the slowdowns, whether it was the East Asian economic crisis or it was the 2008 crisis globally, it had its impact. But the impact on India somewhat was limited because we managed to build firewalls of internal demand and internal capacity within the economy itself. There was, by Indian standards, a slowdown post-2010 for a brief period. But slowdown by our own standards was also still 5 to 6, 6.5% growth rate. And notwithstanding the global slowdown which was witnessed in the last 3 to 4 years, India became a case where neither were too many voices of protectionism within the domestic economy heard, nor was there any slowdown as far as the reform process was concerned. And therefore, in the last few years, we witnessed a series of steps which have been taken. And I think what stands out in India most importantly is that we've now reached a state where the aspirational desire of the Indian people is so high that there is today a popular support behind the reform process. In fact, obstructions of reforms has become most minimal. The voices of protest are most muted. And over the last few years, we've seen steps after steps. For instance, the reforms in the foreign direct investment in India have been significantly expanded, and today we've become one of the most open economies in the world.